this is the last, but certainly not the least panel. And now we're going to try and pull together, I think, the strands of many of the very interesting thoughts we've heard so far and discuss whether there is a grand strategy for the Eurasian Union. And we have three excellent panelists to do that. And we are going to start off with our own Dr. Andrew Kuchins. He is now a senior fellow at the Center for Eurasian, Russian, East European Studies here at Georgetown University. He was previously for many years at the Center for Strategic and International Studies, also at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. He also ran the Carnegie Center in Moscow for a number of years. He's a prolific writer both on Russian foreign policy, on Russian economic issues, and publishes in many different outlets. So, please, we look forward to your remarks. You can either stand or sit, whatever you prefer.
I'd like to be active.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Angela, for the kind introduction. And let me first of all congratulate you and Michael David Fox for holding what has been the most substantive and interesting discussion of the Eurasian Economic Union that I have ever had the pleasure of being involved in. I think the conference has been a great success. Now, at this point in the conference, everything has been said by everybody except for us.
Right.
So, bear with me. Now, the question, is there a grand strategy for the Eurasian Economic Union? The first thing I would say is that grand strategy is a really high bar to achieve for anything, any policy, and particularly any fledgling institution. First of all, a grand strategy requires major strategic goals, and I think as well a sense of how the process would proceed for the implementation of those goals. So it's really, really hard. It's an awful lot to expect. Now, I think it has been clear in our discussion today that the case that within the members of the EEU, there's probably not a shared grand strategy amongst its partners. And so the grand strategy, to the extent that we're going to talk about it, is about Russia. And even in talking about Russia, at different times we've heard very different drivers and or goals highlighted by different Russian officials. Particularly if we go back to June 2009, Vadim, you stole a little bit of my thunder, when the idea reemerged. And here I'll tell a little bit of an anecdote. Because Angela was there with me at the St. Petersburg International Economic Forum in June of 2009. And the U.S. Trade Representative came to the forum. There were expectations that the final negotiations would take place. And as Vadim said, that this would be one of the major deliverables at the July 2009 summit meeting. Well, so what was the major news at the 2009 St. Petersburg International Economic Forum? Well, first of all, the day before it started, on Thursday, Mr. Putin, not too far from St. Petersburg, he, in very theatrical form, read Mr. Deripaska the Riot Act, forced him to sign the piece of paper, and then demanded his pen back. And it was really brilliant political theater as to showing who was the boss in Russia at that time. Now, at the St. Petersburg International Economic Forum, every Russian official, including the president, with responsibility for economic policy, was there with the very significant exception of the Prime Minister, Vladimir Putin. Okay? And then on Monday, Mr. Putin came to the cabinet meeting, at which point he informed the cabinet that Russia's pursuit of the customs union with Kazakhstan and Belarus was to take priority over the WTO accession of Russia, at which point Russia was just very, very small points away from finally achieving. So I think there was a clear message. It was a clear message about the domestic politics of the tandem, so-called tandem in Russia. And I'll return to the importance of thinking about the Eurasian Economic Union in the context of Russian domestic politics a little bit later. But this was a clear message that in case anybody had any misunderstanding about who was boss in Russia, it's Vladimir, not little Dima. And that particularly the U.S. administration, the Obama administration, needed to understand that before Mr. Obama came out to Moscow. So, a domestic political context. Now, subsequent explanation as to what the customs union was about. Well, you know, remember, the Russians announced that, yes, the three countries will enter the WTO as a customs union. The WTO said, I don't think so. This is not how things work. And as Vadim said, it delayed Russia's accession to the WTO by just about 2 years. I'm not sure how long it delayed Kazakhstan's accession to the WTO, but it complicated it. So I remember one explanation, and this was by the Russian face to the West, Deputy Prime Minister Igor Shuvalov, who told us in the fall of 2009 at the Valdai Discussion Club, again, Angela, we were there together, that the customs union will help to assist in raising the norms and standards of WTO aspirant states to WTO levels and ultimately European levels, moving Russia and other post-Soviet states to the quote-unquote greater Europe. Sounds like a rather quaint notion today, but that was one of the first explanations that we heard. Now, Mr. Putin at that time, he would characterize the customs union as an effort to take advantage of Soviet-era supply chains, industrial, transit, infrastructural links that had been underutilized in the post-Soviet period. Now, there may be some rationale for some of these transit links and other infrastructural links to be utilized more, but my question with that has always been that what was built in the Soviet Union was built in a non-market economy context. Suddenly, you find yourself in a market economy, and how much sense does it make, you know, where those factories were built, what direction pipelines were going, et cetera, et cetera. I have a lot of skepticism about that. Okay, later on, we've already heard the reference to Mrs. Clinton's remark about Mr. Putin's efforts in December of 2012, at a time when she was just walking out the door, almost from her position at the State Department, still in the Obama administration, and she was doing that for domestic political reasons, to distance herself from Obama administration policy on Russia, which she basically saw as too soft. Now, of course, the implication there is that it's entirely a political project. We've heard the description, probably a more accurate description, I think, of what the strategy is for the Eurasian Union, which then that came into being with President Putin's presidential campaign in 2012. It was to create a unified economic space between Europe and between China and Asia, in which Russia would play a dominant role in bringing together the interests of other member states. Now, often the EU is pointed to as one of the models for the EU. We've heard some other interesting models today, ASEAN, COMECON, and others. But I think it's useful to take a moment to look at the historical evolution back to the initial roots of the EU, the European Coal and Steel Community. And as Harley pointed out in his comment, this was formally established in May of the Treaty of Paris in 1951. And it was proposed by then French Foreign Minister Robert Schuman as a way to prevent further war between France and Germany. He declared his aim was, quote, make war not only unthinkable, but materially impossible, which was to be achieved by regional integration, of which the ECSC, European Coal and Steel Community, was the first step. And the treaty would create a common market for coal and steel among its member states, which served to neutralize competition between European nations over natural resources, particularly in the Ruhr. Now, this was definitely a very noble strategic goal, a major strategic goal, but I don't think that there was anybody, even at that time, talking about grand strategy, which had a clear vision of how this institution would evolve over the course of many decades into what is the EU today. So again, grand strategy, very, very high bar. So the project took place very much in fits and starts, ebbing and flowing, depending on European leadership, internal and external conditions. Obviously, the goal of the EEU hardly carries the level of that of the ECSC, or what became the EU, to prevent war. Unless, of course, you interpret Russian policy with its neighbors to be join the EEU, or else you will risk being involved in a trade war with Russia, or perhaps a war that could involve military conflict. As remember, it was the origins of the Ukraine crisis over that country's trade and economic orientation back in the fall of 2013, which kind of led us down the road to the Ukrainian crisis that we still have today. Now, there's no question that the Ukraine crisis had a powerful demonstration effect over the existing and potential new members of the EU. In 2014, I traveled to all five of the Central Asian states and all three of the South Caucasus states, and this was very, very, very much on their mind, in a very existential and urgent way. And so this is the context in which the EEU was born. Now, during Mr. Putin's campaign for the presidency in 2012, it became clear that the Eurasian Union, as described then, would constitute a major part of his political legacy henceforth. And that this is, in my view, it gets back to Russia's self-perception of itself as a great power, and great powers must have ambitions and means to exert power and influence beyond their borders. Such an element of Russian national identity dating back to the founding myths of Russia's emergence as a significant international player in the 14th and 15th centuries, the Third Rome, the end of the 15th century, and the like, has been a very, very powerful element of Russian national identity. And, you know, there's a sense that Russia, or the newly rehabilitated term, the Ruski Mir, Russian world, it can never be big enough. The country is the biggest country in the world, but it can never be big enough. It's a separate topic. But the point I want to make, I think, is that the Eurasian Union is a part of Russia's, Putin's, domestic political grand strategy, all right? And here, Mr. Putin, when he returned to the presidency in 2012, the drivers of economic growth that had provided this golden decade or so, the miracle of Russian economic growth, rising oil prices, early on rising oil production, later on easy monetary conditions around the world, also the impact of reforms from the 90s, creating more efficient performance of Russian institutions, etc. He could not count on that into the future. And together with Anders Osland and Sergei Guriev, we edited a book that came out in 2010, and basically the Russia after the global financial crisis. The thesis of that book was that for Russia to continue to grow in a sustainable economic growth, they had to return basically to a structural economic reform agenda and do the right thing to improve the investment environment, et cetera, because they couldn't count on these other mainly external factors which had facilitated Russia's growth for that decade. My concern, though, and after about seeing Mr. Putin in power for 6 months, was that it was clear that he had decided that undertaking that reform agenda was too politically risky. I think a similar decision like the Soviet Politburo made back in the early 1980s, when despite an ocean of petrodollars washing over the Soviet economy, economic growth was about zero, 1981, 1982, and because of the structural inefficiencies. And 2013, economic growth falls to 1.3% on the eve of the invasion of the annexation of Crimea. Russian economic growth is about zero, despite the fact that the oil price is above $100 a barrel. So what does he turn to? Well, he turns to draw on the resources, other resources, to support political legitimacy and credibility. Economic reform is too risky, so he turns to traditional themes of Russian nationalism. We don't have time to go into that, but I think the Eurasian Union fits into this context as part of the domestic political consolidation of Mr. Putin's power. Now, what's the fate of the EU? Well, I agree with what some have said today, that it depends mainly on whether Russia uses this institution for economic, political, coercive powers, or if it genuinely has in mind a partnership that accommodates the economic and political interests of its partners. Anecdotal evidence and data to date are mixed. But look, this is very, very, very early days for this institution. And has been pointed out, the institution itself was born in the midst of perhaps the most rocky economic times imaginable. Okay? So it's too soon to make a comment about that. But I think I'm going to make two last comments about this. See, Angela's getting ready to write a number on a page. and the two last comments have to do with the problem of Russian economic difficulties, which we understand the reasons for, primarily the oil price. What we know today is that the recovery is not going to be a V recovery like it was back in 2008 and 2009. Best case scenario would be a U recovery, where maybe the recovery starts around 2017, hopefully then before the Russian presidential elections. But there's also the real possibility that we could be looking more like a bathtub-like situation, where the recovery would take an extended period of time. And the most recent analog for that would be the period of extended relatively low oil prices from 1985-86. To 2000, okay? Now, if it's somewhere in between the U and this, then I think that's going to put some real constraints on the extent to which Russia is going to be able to sort of implement what it is its vision is. We'll leave it at that. There's been some interesting discussion about that. The last point I want to talk about a little bit more is China and the status of the Chinese economy. So on January, because I think this is an issue that's not received enough attention today and in general. On January 8th of this year, Chinese government announced that the growth rate for 2015 was, I think, 6.9%. Does anybody know when the United States or Japan has announced its growth rate for 2015? Right. Well, we haven't. You know why? Because it takes time to calculate. It's not easy. It's quite a complicated endeavor. So the Chinese announced this on January 8th. Now, let's take into consideration that Christmas is not celebrated, and maybe this is not also their New Year's, and they may work very, very, very hard. But the fact that the announcement of the figure was so soon, and the figure also virtually coincided with what the government had set as the goal, does make one wonder about the veracity, the accurateness of this goal. For those of us who are old enough to have tried to understand and study the growth rates or the GDP of the Soviet Union, this was a real problem. And a lot of the problem, the overestimation of the Soviet economy, had to do with the part that there were plans that took place and there were major incentives for city, regional, et cetera, enterprise bosses, political leaders to say they've actually met the plan when in fact they haven't. Now, the Chinese economy is definitely a more market economy than the Soviet Union, but I think there is a problem there. Now, there was a British firm that came out with an estimation last month. It was, I think, published in the New York Times. I think they tried to measure looking at transit of goods, flow of goods, as an indicator. And they came up with a figure of about 4 to 4.5%. The Japanese have also been working on this issue. They tried to kind of break down different sectors of the Chinese economy and also regions. And in doing so, what they've come up with is a growth rate of about 3.5 to 4%. There something that seems to have that is a very big concern to me that I've seen: capital outflows in China in 2015. They were somewhere between the level of $700 billion and $1 trillion capital outflows. Okay, China still has around $3.4 trillion in foreign currency exchange reserves. Nevertheless, that magnitude of outflows is very, very high indeed. And a significant portion of those outflows we would consider capital flight. And basically, people investing in real estate outside or in banks outside of China because of their concern about the economy. Finally, I think there is, people will point to often the level of foreign currency exchange reserves, but the level of indebtedness of Chinese companies, banks, is one, we don't know exactly what it is, but it's very, very, very high. And we can take by comparison the problem of the bad debts that were on, that the Japanese banks had made in the 1980s during their bubble, and had that led to a period of about 20 years of stagnated economy. Chinese banks are less transparent than Japanese banks. I think there's a lot more problems there. So one of the point I'm making is I think that the likelihood that there are going to be as much money available for China to invest in things like the Asian Infrastructure and Investment Bank, the Silk Road Economic Belt, OBOR, the BRICS Bank, the SCO Development Bank, I think there are going to be real increasing constraints on this. And then for those banks in which others would be supposed to contribute with the Chinese, I think there's going to be a real question about why would you be contributing to a bank which is, they're essentially unrated bonds. And I think in a period in which, you know, where is global growth going to come from is an increasing question mark. So the final point I make is that if we're looking at an extended period of recession, stagnation in Russia, combined with declining growth rates in China, I think all of these plans for Eurasian integration are going to happen a lot more slowly, if they happen at all. Thank you.
Thank you, Andy. Our next speaker is Dr. Vasily Mikheev. He is the Vice President of the Institute for World Economy and International Relations in Moscow, IMEMO, in the Academy of Sciences, and he's been a corresponding member of the Russian Academy of Sciences since 2003. He has worked at the Russian embassies in North Korea and Lithuania, and he's worked at the Institute for Far Eastern Studies and the Carnegie Moscow Center. He's a prolific author, primarily of articles and scholarly works on China and Asia. So, welcome.
Angela, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for inviting me. I have a chance to attend a very important conference and to meet many of my old friends with whom we started to work together more than 10 years ago when Andy was head of Moscow Carnegie office, and he was at Centra and invited all of us in one team. So the question is there a grand strategy for the Eurasian Union? I could answer it in one sentence. In one word.
No.
Two letters.
Starts with N, ends with O.
Two letters. No. If we talk about, but if to be serious, it's not a strategy for Eurasian Union. It's, in my understanding, it's a strategy of Russia on a part of post-Soviet territory. And so if we think about what will happen to the Eurasian Union, the key answer should be linked with what will happen to Russia economy, to its development. My second point is because Angela asked me to, when you invited me, you asked me to touch three things, how Russia sees it, how China, and what to do for European Union and the United States. So the first, how Russia sees it. You know, in my understanding, the concept of Eurasian Union is a Russian response to two strategic challenges. which Russia is facing after the collapse of the Soviet Union. The first challenge is linked with that Russia, just a couple of years after the Soviet Union collapsed, tried to, how our leaders said at that time, to restore the relations between the republics which once had been a member of one big country. And but the concept at the time was theoretically wrong, because the Russian leaders at that time, they tried to restore the relations between Soviet Union republics, which lived on principles of planned economy. They tried to restore these relations in a new situation of market economy. And you know, what's the main difference? Planned economy, you do not practically, you do not buy and sell. You distribute the commodities, the labor force, all the factors of production. And the division of labor, which the Soviet Union established on its territory, it was the division of labor, based on distribution, planned distribution of materials. And in new market relations, it could not work in principle. You know, the most part of the Soviet industry was linked directly or indirectly with military-industrial complex. Military-industrial complex collapsed. So many parts of this complex, which were located in Asia and whole republics, or in Ukraine and Belarus, they stopped absolutely. But market did not create demand for military economy. So that idea was wrong. But that idea of restoration of relations had not only economic but also political meaning. New Russia was dreaming about the times when the Soviet Union was the second biggest power in the world, and of course naturally wanted to become stronger by creation of this commonwealth of independent states. By the way, now, I think and ask my friends, when last time did you hear this CIS in Russian mass media? No, no, nobody could remember, ma'am. 3 years ago, 5 years ago. So the project failed. Officially, of course, the Commonwealth of Independent States is in force, but de facto it doesn't work. So responding to this challenge, Russia made a few attempts. First, creation of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Second, establishment of Eurasian economic, how to say, Commonwealth. In addition, from the military, political side of ODKB, Organization of Collective and Security Treaty. The difference was that Shanghai was with China. Those two organizations were without China. And it was the first respond Russia to the idea of how to involve, engage China in new Russian policy. The problem was that the interests of Russia and China in Central Asia not always coincide. Sometimes they are different. And for Russia, of course, it was more easily to think, to work out, and to make, implement political and economic relations without China. To be the number one boss of the organization, Shanghai, number two bosses. So that's why from CIS, to the Eurasian Economic Commonwealth, and then finally, because initially it was very difficult to combine something from all the members of that Commonwealth, Russia made stress on two countries, more politically and economically close to Russia, and who had with Russia one big border, and you know, it influenced the decision-making process in Kazakhstan and Belarus. So the Eurasian Union appeared as an attempt of Russia to promote its new policy, first on the all post-Soviet territory, Russia didn't succeed. So on the part of the post-Soviet territory. But the second response was China, and was collected with Shanghai collective, Shanghai, Shanghai cooperation, SCO, Shanghai Cooperation Organization. The main contradiction in economy in this organization is that China wants to go deeper, to deeper cooperation, free trade area. It's China goal. In Russia, there's a very strong perception that free trade agreement with China will damage many Russian industries, and many companies will stop, and some of these companies are big companies with important and powerful oligarchs with influence on the government. So when Russia saw that it was difficult to go further together, China first decided to make stress on bilateral relations with different Central Asian countries. At that point, I thought that the next logical step could be creation of similar to Eurasian Union, but without Russia. But China, I guess, understood that such a move could contain a lot of risks of making Russia-China relations worse. So they decided to go another way, this Silk Road project, One Belt, One Road project. It's no, I think it's not only regional, but also global project. And in this situation, what we see now? So Russian strategy was and is to keep its economic and political influence, if not over all the post-Soviet territory, but at least over a part of this territory. But now China, a new factor. 20 years ago, China didn't play any important role. But now China, it's One Belt, One Road project. How to respond to it? And here in Russia, we see two perceptions. First, at the beginning, and now it also exists, but at the beginning, it was the main perception, was that it's a big challenge and a big competition, big maybe a threat to the Eurasian Economic Union. Why? Because transportation, this project undermines Russian transportation projects through Kazakhstan and Siberia and so on. But later, new ideas came to the heads of Russian policymakers. It was based on how China is doing its One Belt, One Road policy, just giving money. So Russian businessmen and government sees now that it's not only competition, but also a chance, an opportunity to get China money and use them for development of very badly developed Russian infrastructure, railroads, and so on. So two approaches. And as a result of these two approaches, Eurasian Economic Union and China signed an agreement about, I cannot say it in English, it's very strange Russian word, very strange. But you could say about uniting these two processes. No, it's not so. But сопряжение, for Russians, it's not easy to understand what it means. Of course, it's psychologically, it's becoming closer. It's for sure. Maybe moving closer. But сопряжение, it's in my practice, I never heard that such kind of word was used in the political language or economic language. But it reflects this double-folded approach to the China activity. On one hand, it's a risk. On other hand, it's a chance. So that's why not friendship, not integration, not cooperation, but сопряжение. I don't know in English how to say it really, Andy, maybe you know, not easy. What, from this point of view, what will be the future strategy of Eurasian Union? It will be, it's not formulated, but logically it will be very simple. Russia will try to get as many benefits from cooperation, from сопряжение with China as it is possible. However, here there are some technical problems in our cooperation with China, and some Russian people from the government, they don't like the situation. What I mean, that China giving money for infrastructure insists that Russian companies use China technology, China materials. Creating a demand for China domestic production. Now, China economy slows down, domestic demand slows down, so China is logically working for new markets. So to substitute export of commodities export of capital. It's normal, logical development of capitalism everywhere. But if we talk through this prism about Russia-China relations, we see that it becomes a big impediment in realizing this concept of сопряжение. That's why I think that maybe understanding all these difficulties in possible difficult future difficulties in our cooperation between Eurasian Union and China, this word сопряжение was used because it's not clear, not doesn't have the real meaning. So I have to finish now and answering. Finishing my presentation, let me say once again, I do not see that there is a strategy for Eurasian Union. It's a strategy of Russia on the part of the post-Soviet territory, that China approach, there will be relations between China and Eurasian Union of competition and cooperation. Of course, some countries like Belarus and Kazakhstan will try to play on the differences in China and Russia positions, trying to get more more economic aid from China and from Russia, but first of all from China. So it will add to one Russia strategy also two more strategies, maybe four more, but I talk about the main members, Kazakhstan and Belarus, two more members of Eurasian Union. So it will not be in the coming future a strategy of Eurasian Union as a single organization, as a one organization. It will be strategy of Russia first, then small countries, as usual, playing on the contradictions between interests of big powers. Now China is a new big power, but it will give chances to some Russian businesses, to some Eurasian Union businesses. So that's all. Thank you.
Thank you. And our final speaker on the panel is Aitolkyn Kourmanova. She, in Kazakhstan, she headed the Central Asia Institute for Economic Strategies, and she launched the economic magazine Vox Populi. She has been a fellow, a research fellow at George Washington University's Central Asia Program, and also at CSIS.
Thank you very much. Can I speak?
You can, that's fine.
Well, it's really challenging to speak at the end of this conference. We had a really great day of discussions. We heard so many things about the Eurasian Union in details. And I would speak more from the Central Asia perspective. It's how the Central Asia countries see the Eurasian Union and how the Eurasian Union fit into their broader foreign policy goals. And we should really say that the year of 2015 was really difficult for Central Asia. And I'm sure that 2016 will be also very problematic, especially as it marks the 25th anniversary of the independence. And this, in fact, is a really significant time span. And I think that the time really accelerates so quickly that we kind of anticipate some changes. And we know that these changes will take place in the next few years. But we really don't know whether these changes would be for the better or for the worse. From the one hand, yes, Central Asia is indeed back into a spotlight. But we have really serious regional economic crisis being developing here. And we have geopolitical tensions around it. And we have, of course, these different competing integration projects, and we, as we discussed today. And as my professor Marlene Lorraine notes in her recent paper, Central Asia also suddenly becomes a place of myth creation with all these imaginary pictures of Silk Road, great games, caravans, etc. And in fact, I think that both the Eurasian vision and the new Silk Road, whether it is American project or Chinese project, they really want to romanticize the Central Asian history. They call Central Asia countries to remember their history. But from the other hand, they really focus a lot on their geographical location other than any other characteristics. And as Russian economist Vladislav Inozemtsev just recently wrote, it's just like Silk Road for him is just the land. This is everything is about the land. So, but at the same time, I think that Central Asian countries, they do not really buy these historical illusions. They continue to be really very pragmatic. And as Professor Cooley, who presented today, he wrote in his famous book that they really continue to play their little local games. And they really use the international competition to their own advantage. But as regards the Eurasian Economic Union, I think that they will use these games or their practice that already had been built to the disadvantage of Russia mainly, because they have this big card as China, and China is really a big player now. It's a main trade partner and main investor for the region. And but even without China, as we heard today, I mean, within the Eurasian Economic Union, Kazakhstan and Belarus, they really learned how to effectively withstand to the Russian pressures on acceleration of the integration. They really know how to use different measures like non-tariff barriers and everything else. So they kind of learned how to provide some protection of their interests, and they do that out of their own interests, yeah. So whether pragmatic or not, but we see really these new additions to the Central Asian foreign policies, and it's not a surprise that they continue to do their multi-vector foreign policies. And particularly in Kazakhstan, which is under the highest pressure probably, we see the new concept, which is called Big Eurasia. And so the Big Eurasia is actually something, that, again, maybe imaginary mega block, which kind of embraces the cooperation between European Union, Eurasian Economic Union, and the Chinese One Belt, One Road. Actually, the Kazakh Ministry of Foreign Affairs just really attaches a big importance to this new concept, and you can hear it really quite often in the speeches. We see, for instance, some modifications in Turkmenistan's neutrality status. We see that Turkmenistan is actually turning into a very active regional player, and it's looking in basically in every direction to diversify its gas exports. Uzbekistan, of course, is a difficult example, but I think even there, at least according to the reports that I read from the state think tanks, I see that they think of regional economic policy more often now, and there was a recent report that says that Uzbekistan chemistry industry, for example, should really try to create new regional value chains and cooperate more closely with Kazakhstan. So there are some modifications here, at least in terms of regional cooperation. I'd like to talk some a little bit more. So talking about pragmatism of the country, we should also say that they really know how to calculate the things economically, and the economic rationale of the Eurasian Union in the form that it was offered a few years ago was really based, I mean, we know that there are many interests for Kyrgyzstan, for instance, to have their migrants there, to there are many political reasons and security reasons why the Eurasian Union is really viewed as very significant or no alternative, but also the whole economic structure of the Eurasian Union is that it is a closed customs bloc, and where members would use higher external tariffs to develop their own production capacities and openly trade with each other, while the access to the Russian market was like a carrot and main economic incentive. And this has really turned out to be a very incredibly difficult task to implement for everyone. And I think it's not only because of economic slowdown, not because of the lack of demand in Russia, not even because Kazakh or Kyrgyz entrepreneurs are really so uncompetitive. There was also a missing promise in this vision, it's foreign investment. And I think that initially it was thought that foreign investors would come to the region and they would help the member countries to set up the production chains because they see the opportunities of this enlarged market so well. But these hopes have not realized, and I think that the EU in some sort really had kind of created a wall around it, like the Soviet Union did. So this is like a wall for the new technologies, for the new imports, for the new for everything new. And first of all, because it's economically too expensive to import technologies and components because of high tariffs. Oops, sorry for that. And even the Kyrgyz textile industry, I mean, they suffer not only because, or not primarily because there is a slowdown of demand in Russia or Kazakhstan, but because the components from China, they use a lot of components from China and they're very expensive now. And with the devaluation of the currencies all across Central Asia, it's also a big issue. But also the sanction regime, I mean, the political factor is also to blame because even the big Russian companies are not able now to buy foreign components and foreign technologies. This is the case for some Russian energy companies. So that kind of stops the flow of new investment in the region, and that kind of raises the question how the countries can industrialize themselves, and particularly in a matter of several years, and particularly with the current political climate, which is not very open and favorable for the entrepreneurs of the region. And I think, I mean, it's again, the analogy with the Soviet Union means really very, kind of not very true maybe, but we have more expensive products, we have products of lower quality, and we just trade them with each other, and we see less and less of foreign products and services. So on the contrary, the economic rationale of the Chinese Silk Road is really much more simple and much more feasible than the rationale of the Eurasian Union. China is both an investor and a customer. So the countries receive both financial and technical assistance to build the new roads and new infrastructure. And the roads are really much easier to build than the new plants. They employ more people. Even with all the Chinese imports of Chinese labor, we still have some room to create more jobs in the region. We can create additional demand for small and medium enterprises. We can use our local construction and logistics materials and services. And these are really opportunities for longer term because the roads will be there for a very long term and you just do nothing but utilize them. And in this sense, the historical illusion does work because Central Asia really sees or is much more prepared to see itself as a transit hub rather than a highly industrialized region. And so there is no wonder, I think, that given that the Eurasian Union brought really many disputes and kind of polarized the societies within the Eurasian, within the Central Asia, given rise to nationalism in Kazakhstan, for instance. I think that unlike that, Chinese One Belt, One Road was really unanimously supported by the Central Asian leaders. And they don't really declare that on public, they really invest hard cash. They invest the highest shares of their budgets and even of their funds for the future generation, like Kazakhstan is using its national oil fund, Uzbekistan is using its fund for reconstruction and development, and the highest focus here are infrastructural projects along the Chinese Silk Road, rather than the new plans to serve the Russian market. So with this in mind, I think with this, with Chinese being the prime economic player in the region, I don't think that there is any way that the Eurasian Economic Union can be an exclusive integration project in the economic terms, and I think everyone understands that quite well. And that brings the second question that you asked is whether Eurasian Economic Union can be cooperative with China and West. And I think that, yes, it just doesn't have any choice. It has to cooperate with the Chinese plan, but how and in what form, these are really open questions. And Mr. Mikheev said about the free trade zone with China, that China is really wants to have this free trade zone and Russia is really opposed to that. But I think that this issue will inevitably arise in the next stage of the Chinese development. I mean, you have new roads, you have new railways, you have new infrastructure, and what do you do? I mean, where do you have the goods and how these goods will be transported along these roads? I mean, that was a lot of criticism of this Chinese plan, that it doesn't really think of that. I mean, the new roads per se do not lead to economic prosperity, and we need some goods. We need some high goods, high-tech goods, first of all, because to compensate for the distance. And we need some really new rules, more liberal rules of trade, lower barriers to trade. We need faster border checks and so on. So, I mean, there are so many other factors to make this traffic a reality. And I think that the Chinese will have to think about it, at least in the in the medium term. And so for the positive scenario of the changes, if we want really to see the Central Asia changes as really positive, I think the regional market should really be broadened. It shouldn't be exclusivist, or it shouldn't have any zero-sum competition. I think there should be links to every direction, north, south, west, east, and it should really become more flat with horizontal links and connectivity. And the Eurasian Union and Russia in particular should really realize that this is something to do in its own interest, as somebody spoke today. So Russia should really consider how to remain influential and how to keep its presence in Central Asia, how to remain attractive. And I'd like here to talk about the case of Uzbekistan. I think it's really interesting because Uzbekistan is not a member of the Eurasian Economic Union, and I don't think that it will be unless, while Mr. Kourmanova is in power. But it really trades the most with Russia from all Central Asian countries. Russia is still, it's the only one in the region where Russia is a number one trading partner. And according to local statistics and official statistics, of course, there is some more estimates from the, I think, IMF states that no, China is soon to overcome that. But local Uzbek and Russian statistics, they say that Russian trade share in Uzbekistan's trade balance is almost twice as much as of China. And also we have Russian investors in the energy sector of Uzbekistan. We have Uzbekistan exporting the highest volume of manufactured goods to Russia. And just recently there was a piece of news that kind of struck me as strange amid all these Chinese projects, that Uzbekistan is actually building a new railway to the north, which means to Russia, not to the south or to the east. And so yes, Uzbekistan resists Russia politically, but it cooperates with it economically. And being a member of the, not being the member of the Eurasian Union, I mean, you can still have some economic ties and you can have this economic pragmatism. So I think although, Mr. Mikheev said that Russia does not want to discuss actual free trade zone, I think that this is something that should be if we want to really to see the region as win-win. And maybe something like the Eurasian free trade space or the Eurasian free trade something. I mean, we should ask Mr. Nazarbayev for a better definition. He likes this kind of, but it should be a region. I mean, that would be something that everyone would really benefit. And because really, I don't think that the Eurasian Union can stay as an exclusive. It can only complement the Chinese in economic and trade areas. But we don't know if the current Russian administration will ever think about it. It's kind of downgrading the Eurasian Union for them. But from the other hand, it really provides more viability and more win-win solutions, or with this energy, as Mr. Cho said today, with all this, be more open, allow more competition, and allow more liberalism. But I don't know, maybe that's another myth. So I'll stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, we have some time for questions. So if anyone has questions, all right, we'll start with you.
Hi, quick question. When you look at the economy as a whole, it's kind of like a jelly sandwich. You put pressure from the top, you put pressure from the bottom, the middle goes splat, right? So we've been talking very much about sort of upper level, elite level economic pressures. And I was wondering, how do you see more what I would call the retail level, the more everyday person economic transaction level playing into this whole Eurasian Union thing? Because I can't help but thinking the first time I went to Russia was under the Soviet Union, and you took it for granted that you wouldn't find Nutella but in the foreign exchange store. And now I think there's a whole generation of people that's grown up with Nutella available every day. And if it goes away, you know, at that level, how do you see that playing into some of the considerations that the government puts into developing its policies?
Randy, you want to take the mic?
Yeah. Thank you. I just wanted to make a comment mostly in terms of how the business community views the Eurasian Economic Union, because it really has been a very important development for companies that are doing business in the region. I think that if you look at standards, if you look at tariffs, if you look at customs rules, all these are rules of origin. These are all things that companies are looking at, and it's not just that it's an idea, that it's a political motivated organization, although obviously political pressures do come to bear regularly into the rules making process. And I do think it's important to take that into consideration, that this is real and that companies have to deal with this, and they are taking it very seriously. I haven't felt that in the discussion that I was only here in the afternoon, so I really haven't felt that as part of this, that it's not just a political idea or concept. And, you know, I do think if you look at all the tariff structures in and of themselves, you know, Russia, when it was doing its WTO accession, one of the things was that its tariffs weren't really high. They don't have high external tariffs. And they were imposing a lot of their will in these Eurasian Economic Union discussions of the formation of this. So that is less of a concern. I think people are looking very carefully at, you know, how does this work together? Because maybe it's not the most attractive market in the world at this point in time, but there is a lot of potential there, and the ease of doing business, this plays into that. And the bureaucracy, and I think somebody mentioned this earlier, the bureaucracy at the Eurasian Economic Union actually works as a positive force in some of these rules. I know in the area of intellectual property, for example, they've been a positive counterweight in Russian discussions on policy and intellectual property. So I just wanted to throw that out. One question maybe, and I don't know if this is at all on people's radar, is that we've just had this week a change in the command at the Eurasian Economic Union. Mr. Khrushchenko is no longer the chairman. The chairman is now the now former ambassador from Armenia to the United States. Russia's own position within the Eurasian Economic Commission is changing, because now with five countries, they get two ministers instead of three. And actually, you know, from what I understand, we're going to have Ms. Vilevaya will stay on, and Ms. Nikishina, who's been, as far as we had engagement, a positive force within the Russian government, is coming into play as a minister there representing Russia. So for us, that's a positive development.
Thank you very much. I mean, I should say that Ms. Levina, she works at the U.S.-Russia Business Council, and, you know, the U.S. government officials, we mentioned this before, tend to be rather skeptical about the Eurasian Economic Union, so I think it's very important to have a U.S. business perspective here, and obviously for you, this is a serious organization that has quite some benefits, so thank you for that contribution. Is there another? Yes, over here.
Thank you very much for an amazing discussion. My name is Dursun Jamal Halimva. I'm a visiting scholar at GW from Turkmenistan. So my question is related to the role of Central Asia, I guess, and anyone can answer. When we talk about Central Asia, we tend to think of it as a one sole entity, like united entity, one thing. But I see it as a region which is so disconnected. There is lack of cooperation, there is lack of economic, political cooperation, or any kind of cooperation, and lack of trade, actually. There is minimum trade going on within the region. although there is a huge potential. So I was wondering, how essential it is to see greater political and economic cooperation within Central Asian countries, governments, if you want to see any of these initiatives, either it's Russian-led, Chinese-led, American or European-led, if you want to see these initiatives to succeed in the long run, how essential it is to have political and economic cooperation within Central Asian governments? And if you think it is essential, do you see it happening in the near future? Thank you.
Thank you. That's a great question. I was going to raise that to you too. There are a few of us here that attended the Astana Forum in November, and it was a great, very interesting international discussion. There was only one issue. There weren't any other Central Asians there. It was just Kazakhs and then people from China and the US and Europe and India, Pakistan, etc. So would you like to start off by
answering? Sure, yeah. I mean, this is something that I really have been working on for several years, regional cooperation, regional economic cooperation in Central Asia. And I mean, yes, in terms of, I think that the, why the things are really changing now in Central Asia, why we see, you know, President Karimov going to Turkmenistan, or Turkmen president going to Uzbekistan, and we see really increasing tempo of these visits within the region. It's because really we are witnessing that in the current geopolitical environment, in the current economic environment, the idea of Central Asia, of course not unity and of course not integration, but at least some regional platform is already in the air. And the big kind of thing that kind of emboldened the Central Asian countries to seek further, I think, was C5+1, even though it was a very, the initiative of the US, even though it was a very, I mean, it's a very generic platform and we don't know when they will have the second meeting. It's already, it says that there is some support for this kind of discussions within the region. But I mean, there are many factors that can benefit the Central Asian countries to trade with each other more often, to have cross-country investment, to set up new regional production chains, to really utilize the new Silk Road from China to their own advantage, and to not to build, you know, double duplicating projects, but really to sit at one table and kind of discuss how you do that further, because even, you know, for the border controls and for the for everything else, I mean, you need some cooperation. I think this there are some drivers, and I think that this is, of course, this is something positive, and of course the probably one of the most difficult barriers were the regimes. I mean this sovereignty, the focus on sovereignty of our presidents, and we'll see really. But I think that in the next 3 to 5 years, that would be a big issue.
Vasily, you have any comments on
that? Let me mention a couple of points. First, about whether it is union or not, we do not have visas, and people and commodities can move more or less free, but the union doesn't have a single union custom border. So if somebody wants to bring goods to Russia through Belarus or Kazakhstan, he pays taxes, custom taxes, not on the border between, for example, Poland or Belarus, but he pays taxes in Russia. So it will take time to turn this union, which is in on the paper written, into real union. It's one of the examples. Another thing I would like to tell you, the problem is that, you know, it's trade among the members of the union, trades inside the bloc and trade to outside the bloc. So the share of trade inside the bloc, for example, in European Union, more than 60% of all, NAFTA 40-something. Even ASEAN, which export-oriented, has almost a quarter of ASEAN exports sold inside the bloc. Regarding members of the Eurasian Union, for Russia, it's figure 7% something, for Kazakhstan, nearby 20%. And only Belarus has more than 50% of inside the bloc. It's easy to explain because for Russia and Kazakhstan, the main exports is energy resources. And for Belarus, energy resources, it's import and export of something like that. Another thing which I think is important, it's that the relations between three members of the Eurasian Union are not so friendly and reliable. One example, you know, after sanctions, I call this sanctions against Russia, which Russia imposed, because Russia stopped import products from Europe. So in Russian, it's called self-sanctions. Is it possible to say it in English? Summer sanctions. Self,
sure.
Self-sanctions. So we...
like summer censure.
Yes. We knew, surprisingly, that Belarus is a big exporter of fresh oysters, salmon, other types of fish. We never knew it, but export of Spanish or French, you know, these onions or olives, everything. That's just took this sanction margin, making some tricks with the papers on the bottles and so on. So it will take time. So countries become trust each other and follow the joint rules, not trying to get this sanctions or other bad situation margin. And the last point about Central Asian Union. I think its idea, Central Asian integration cooperation, it already exists. Eurasian Union, Russia, plus few Central Asian countries, and now also Kyrgyzstan joined the Eurasian Union. So if you mean this Central Asian Union without Russia and China, it looks like a beautiful idea. But immediately, suspicion will grow up very quickly in Russia. What does it mean? It's against Russia? Kazakhstan, the main player of this organization, if it ever happens, is a member of Eurasian Union. I'm not sure about China. China can try to play on this idea in favor of trying to strengthen China positions in Central Asia, but I'm not sure China will support it. But because against such kind of idea, they show that a group of small countries tries to act against interests of big countries in the region. So idea is very beautiful, but I have some reservations about. Thank you.
Andy.
Thanks.
I don't know if you can also address the first question that we got.
Well, the first one was kind of what's happening on the ground in Central Asia or Russia. That would probably be outside of my purview, but I wanted to amplify some things that Randy said on the role of the business community. You know, when the idea of the customs union first reemerged, you know, I was really pretty adamantly opposed to it. It was like, how could you prioritize the customs union over the WTO accession and say that this is better for, you know, Russian economic modernization? I had a pretty strong position, but one of the first discussions that I had in Moscow, not maybe 6 months after that announcement, was with a representative of a large American company, the Russian guy, government relations person, who told me the story that it was actually where AmCham and the Russian Union of Entrepreneurs and Industrialists kind of worked together to help to lobby the Russian government to move forward with the customs union, with the argument that they saw it in their interest as this would create greater openness and access to other markets, particularly to Kazakhstan, I think was the first issue. And secondly, on the, you know, kind of even more so on this point, you know, one of the speakers we'd invited to come here and was unable to come at the last minute. His name is Rocky Mashkabayev. He's now Russian Deputy Minister for
Kazakh.
Freudian slip, my bad. Kazakh deputy minister for economic trade and development, but he was just named this position a few months ago. Previously, he was representing a business lobbying organization that had been specially created by Nazarbayev to bring together a forum for Kazakh business, maybe something kind of like the Russian, what the Russians do with the entrepreneurs and industrialists, but to have them, for them to have a forum where they could lobby the government. And they and he was sort of the representative node that was kind of representing Kazakh business interests in the negotiations over the Eurasian Economic Union. And there was a lot of, just a lot of to and fro, and it gave them a forum to kind of advance their interests. And so, you know, often there are sort of unintended consequences of the creation of institutions. So you do have a large bureaucracy. You do have a forum where these now five countries come together, and it does create the opportunity actually for business interests perhaps to have, you know, more voice within their own governments to advance their own interests, which could be positive. The other thing I just want to say, that the question about you know, is greater, you know, cooperation in Central Asia, would it be a good thing? I think unabashedly yes. I got involved in this issue 6 years ago, seven years ago, with a project we did at CSIS on the Northern Distribution Network. Then we kind of looked at some of the lessons from the Northern Distribution Network and how that could be applied to thinking about a regional economic cooperation strategy for Afghanistan, including Central Asia. And we called it the Modern Silk Road. Then it eventually got adopted by the administration, the new Silk Road. But there is no forum for Central Asian countries to come together by themselves without another external power. And the one effort to create that back in the 1990s, the Central Asian Union, was basically kind of shut down by the Russians by losing a lot of muscle to do so. But I think that, you know, whether it's the Americans or the Russians, you know, or the Chinese or the Europeans who are hoping to, like, promote greater integration and cooperation, there has to be the impulse itself from the countries in the region. And we worked on this quite a bit the last couple of years, including with Aya at CSIS. And often the response we got was, you know, this is sort of the project for maybe the next generation. And the current leadership, they don't really have high hopes. I think when you look at the different countries right now, these are basically authoritarian patrimonial regimes, and their interests are more, you know, are they really acting in what one might construe as the national interest, or are they acting in the interests of a few people? And they're making sure that, you know, their patrons are satisfied. And that, frankly, that is the biggest obstacle you know, more economic cooperation within the region and the region with others. So it is going to require some political change and political reform.
Great. We can take one more round of questions. All right, over here.
I'm Guljigit from Kyrgyzstan. I'm also a GW visiting scholar. And to echo what Andrew just said now, it would be interesting to hear your comment on possible perceived or real conditionalities in terms of the regime choice, political regime, economic policies to exist in this union without any trouble. I don't know if I was making sense.
You're talking about rules within the Eurasian Union that have to do with domestic political transitions.
If you see any conditionalities which are tangible now to for the countries, for the member countries in the union, in terms of choices for political development, for economic development.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's a good question for us.
Any other questions? This is your last chance. Okay. This is the final question then. Why don't we start off with you, Andy?
Okay, let me make sure that I understood the question properly. Do we see evidence now of or indicators of greater cooperation within Central Asia? Or, I'm sorry, can you rephrase it?
I mean,
someone mentioned about sort of in relation to this union, I mean, to EU, someone mentioned something like a term authoritarian international. And the question is related to that. I mean, if you look at the union in a broader terms, not only to three countries, but some other smaller countries and some potential members, do you see any diversity in the choice of political regime?
Oh, I see.
In the choice
yeah.
of economic, yeah. Mode of economic development?
Yeah, I think it would sort of be, do you think the Eurasian Economic Union would have an impact going forward on the domestic political systems of the different member states?
That's an interesting question, and I think it kind of gets back to the a way sort of the line of Randy Levinas's comment and my comment on her comment, in that while you know sort of the conventional wisdom is that the Eurasian Economic Union is an institution to promote the increase of Russian economic and political dominance in the region, it is entirely possible that the institution itself would evolve in a way in which it could promote first of all a more plural, if you will, and set of relationships, I mean, within the Eurasian Economic Union itself. You know, again, my view on the Eurasian Economic Union is that it's gonna succeed if it, in fact, is a forum for give and take, you know, where there's compromise and where there's accommodation of interests. And if it moves in the direction of, you know, one of the three model, the sort of imperial model that Bobo Lowe talked about at lunch, you know, then I think it's going to be one of these, it'll become what Harley Balzer referred to earlier as a zombie institution, which exists on paper and which is not, in which the sort of the, you know, the rules and norms which it is supposed to propagate are not abided by its members. So this remains to be seen. And you know, I think there are some positive things that we've seen, and that you know, even in 2015, and that, you know, Belarus and Kazakhstan and Armenia were able to get things and negotiations over the terms of the Eurasian Economic Union that initially I don't think that Russia was willing to provide. So that's, you know, I remember being in Armenia in June of 2014, and we went to visit the Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs, who had a responsibility for Europe, and you know, he was kind of beleaguered because, you know, Armenia was ready to sign the direct, deep and comprehensive free trade agreement with the EU in early September of 2013, and basically they turned on a dime because of a phone call from Moscow, I think. And they're told not to, and that was a big disappointment to the Europeans. Well, at least it wasn't a huge disappointment to Europe, I suppose. But in the context of European problems, let me not exaggerate things. But look, but then, so what the Armenians were doing was okay. So then their strategy boiled down to, we are going to basically, on a case by case by, you know, basis, negotiate the content of a deep and comprehensive free trade agreement, the components of it, but without it being called a deep and comprehensive free trade agreement with the Europeans, which they had some success doing. And also, they were busy at that time. I think they said they were, you know, they were looking at 900 different statutes in the Eurasian Economic Union initial draft that they were kind of contesting and they wanted revised. And I think it was in Alex, in your presentation today, that you said they were successful in some revision of 700 of them. So the forum exists. There's going to be give and take. We already see evidence of that.
Yeah.
And поживем увидим.
Vasily.
You see, if I understood the question correctly, in short term and medium term, for Russia, it does not matter what kind of regime wants to cooperate with Russia. And the Russia matters only one thing. It should be not pro-American, and it should follow Russian policy, economic policy, and so on. So in this Russian position, and even Russian diplomacy underlines this point and sees that Russia is more close to China economic diplomacy, because China doesn't demand regime change in the countries with which it develops relations. So from this point of view, if we talk about enlargement of Eurasian Union, Russian position is that we do not care about the political system. Just you should, if you want, you are welcome, but we should discuss the economic conditions. But from the long-term perspective and from practical economy, I do not think that the union where political systems are differ from each other. I don't think that such kind of union can develop quickly, successfully, and for a long time. And just underline one thing more. It's a very big and interesting problem. What is the correlation between democracy and economic development? And I just want to say that, in my understanding, democracy is important, first of all, itself, because the life of human beings is not limited with what they produce, buy, and sell. There are many other needs in the minds of people. So if we want to talk about strong union, the real union, we should also take into consideration all the needs of the people, not only those needs which are related to economical sphere of our life. From this perspective, of course, it's very difficult to understand how such kind of organization can survive in the long.
Thank you. Want to add anything?
Oh, no.
Okay. So one more anecdote. You get the last word, Andy.
Oh, no. You're getting very profound. I just wanted to extend my comment to your question, because there was the Armenian case. But I'm not sure that the Russians were opposed. I mean, it's not inconceivable that Armenia could have signed a deep and comprehensive free trade agreement with Europe and joined the Eurasian Economic Union from the standpoint of Russia. I think maybe the might have been more of a problem from the standpoint of the European Union, which in my view is a mistake on the part of the European Union, because I think this got us into the problem over all of these countries need to pursue a multi-vector foreign policy. You need ties with the West, you need ties with Russia, you need ties with China, or Iran, et cetera. And so to make one orientation exclusive of the other, I think, is a real mistake. But the point I wanted to make about Kyrgyzstan, because I think the Kyrgyz case was different from the Armenian case. And I remember in going to visit the then Prime Minister, Mr. Atarbayev, in the summer of 2014, and walking to he's an old friend, and walking into his office, and the first thing he said was, "Andy, can you please ask your colleagues at the State Department to stop telling us to not join the Eurasian Economic Union? And because, look, we're going to do it because we think it's in our interests. And we really don't, we see it as necessary to advance Kyrgyz national interests. That's our decision. We don't see that as not being imposed upon us. And also, by the way, there has not been one major American company that's made a significant investment in Kyrgyzstan, in 23, 24 years since the collapse of the Soviet Union. I felt kind of badly about that. And I think there tends to be the conception here that a lot of this is simply imposed upon the states in the region. It's kind of, then it gets described in kind of black and white terms, when I think the reality is a lot more complicated.
Great. Before we thank our panel, I would just like to thank the CERES team who made this conference possible, Benjamin Loring, Christina Watson, Lauren Mansour, and I would again like to thank Chevron and Jay Thompson, Georgetown graduate, of course, for helping this make this happen. So please join me in thanking the panel.